The deadly militant raid on a hotel complex in Kenya has raised questions about whether the security forces have learned any lessons from past terror attacks, including the five-day siege on the Westgate shopping center in 2013. These days, individuals and vehicles entering any major public premises in Kenya usually have to go through checks by private security companies involving a range of tools, metal detectors, X-ray machines, bomb detectors and sniffer dogs. So Kenyans have varying opinions about how seriously the security personnel take this process. One place where they would be expected to be conscientious is the scene of the latest attack. The complex that includes the Dusit 2 Hotel, known by its address, 14 Riverside. It is home to a variety of businesses and a major hotel, which was frequented by professionals, government officials and foreigners. In other words, the kind of location that the Somalia-based militant group al-Shabab would target, knowing that the world would notice. Yet however strict the security measures and however conscientious those enforcing them are, there is only so much the building owners can do to secure their property and clientele. As Tuesday's events highlighted, the main responsibility lies with the Kenyan authorities. Most of the recent al-Shabab attacks on Kenyan soil have been around the border with Somalia, which appeared to feel a semblance of control and stability in the rest of the country amid a lingering threat. This however assumes that al-Shabab always plans its major actions in Somalia. Risk analyst Mathias Muindi thinks that this latest attack has signs that there was some level of preparation by Kenyan militant cells. The evidence collected about the attack suspects has revealed links to parts of Kenya that are traditionally non-Muslim and non-Somali, where security agencies may not have previously paid much attention. He says, "The problem now is that they do not have the adequate manpower to run an expanded and robust nationwide intelligence operation." Read more about the militants. The quality and effectiveness of the government's anti-terror efforts will be scrutinized yet again, in particular whether crucial intelligence from local and foreign sources is acted upon. Kenyan intelligence officials argue that over the years they have had successes intercepting some suspected militants, potentially preventing more attacks and proving that they are making progress. They add that it has been nearly 5 years since the attack on university campus in the town of Garissa, and more than 5 years since similar attack in the capital, referring to the Westgate siege in 2013. The suggestion is that such incidents are not the norm. Clearly, some lessons were learned from Westgate. The scale and the depth of the emergency response police and the military counter-terror units, foreign security personnel, ambulance and fire brigade that arrived at 14 Riverside showed organization. In contrast to the shambles 5 years ago, security agents arrived relatively quickly and showed composure as they evacuated civilians and screened them before letting them go, to be sure that the attackers did not slip out unnoticed. However, there were still some worrying lapses. Security officials delayed enforcing a strict security cordon, meaning that there could have been more civilian casualties if there had been further explosions. A tactic al-Shabab has used in Somalia, a suspicious vehicle in the car park that security agents thought could have been used by the attackers remained unattended. footage also showed an unexploded grenade lying in a corridor of one of the buildings as security agents shuffled in and out a few feet away. There are wider issues to consider for Kenya's security chiefs. There is a lot of spending on training the security forces, yet with only see limited effects because their welfare is poor, says George Musamali, the director of a private security firm. Training is not enough. Equipping is not enough. Something needs to be done about human resources to make sure that these people are fully motivated to do their work properly. He also calls for a better channel of communication between the government and the public, not just in the aftermath of attacks, but as a norm so that intelligence from the civilians can be properly gathered and used. The government responded to this week's attack by using a familiar tactic, downplaying the impact of al-Shabab's actions. This is part of an active effort to control the narrative and win the propaganda war that has accompanied this insurgency. Kenyans were warned against sharing gruesome images from the attack, and on Tuesday evening, Interior Minister Fred Matiang'i announced that the affected buildings had been secured and the security forces were mopping up the area. But this came as members of the public were reporting that their friends and relatives were still in the complex, hiding from the attackers. Mr. Musamali feels the government's tone only pushes away the public and loses their trust. The government is up against a group that has arguably the most advanced media operation of any militant Islamist movement in Africa, including established radio and digital outfits. It often filmed these attacks in Somalia, including the devastating assault on a Kenyan army base in the town of Eldoret, exactly 3 years to the day of this week's attack. Some of its media material is produced in Swahili, clearly targeting audiences in Kenya, revealing its cross-border ambitions. The threat will not go away in the short term, and the changes still need to be made. Andrew Franklin, a Nairobi-based security consultant on the ex-United States Marine, said it is clear that the government security agencies and the many private security companies are not working together enough, and that is evident in the obvious security glitches around Nairobi. Yet again, Kenya has suffered a big loss, and as its people come to terms with this week's events, they will wonder why it has to take catastrophes. Far more lessons to be learned. A poacher has been ordered to watch the Disney film Bambi repeatedly after he was convicted of illegally killing hundreds of deer. Missouri hunter David Barry, Jr., must view the film at least once a month during his year-long sentence. He was arrested in August along with two family members for killing the deer, taking their heads and leaving their bodies to rot. Prosecutors said it is reportedly one of the biggest poaching cases in Missouri history. On top of the jail sentence for the illegal deer hunting, Judge Robert George ordered Barry Jr. to view the Walt Disney movie Bambi, with the first viewing being on or before December 24, 2018. And at least one such viewing each month thereafter, during his spell in prison. The 1,942 cartoon about woodland creatures shows a hunter kill the mother of eponymous deer character Bambi. A month-long investigation, spanning several states, led to the arrest of Barry Jr., his father David Barry, Sr., and his brother Kyle Barry. According to local newspaper, the Springfield News-Leader, While the total number of deer taken illegally is unknown, Lawrence County's conservation agent Andy Barnes said it could be several hundred. Barry Giro received a year-long sentence in Lawrence County prison after pleading guilty to illegally taking wildlife. He has also been sentenced to a 120-day term in Barton County Prison for a firearms probation violation, and both he and his father had their hunting privileges revoked for life by the Missouri Conservation Commission. A poacher has been ordered to watch the Disney film Bambi repeatedly after he was convicted of illegally killing hundreds of deer. Missouri hunter David Barry Jr. must view the film at least once a month during his year-long sentence. He was arrested in August along with two family members for killing the deer, taking their heads and leaving their bodies to rot. Prosecutors said it is reportedly one of the biggest poaching cases in Missouri history. On top of the jail sentence for the illegal deer hunting, Judge Robert George ordered Barry Jr. to view the Walt Disney movie Bambi, with the first viewing being on or before December 24th.